Mari, jemaat yang dikasihi Tuhan, kita akan bersama-sama memperkatakan apa yang dimaksud dengan Pentakosta ketiga dan Mazmur 91. Apa yang dimaksud dengan Pentakosta ketiga? 1. Pentakosta ketiga adalah pencurahan Roh Kudus yang dahsyat di zaman ini, melebihi yang terjadi di Azusa Street. 2. Pentakosta ketiga akan mengakibatkan penuaian jiwa yang terbesar dan yang terakhir sebelum Tuhan Yesus datang kembali. 3. Pentakosta ketiga akan membangkitkan generasi Yeremia, yaitu anak-anak muda yang dipenuhi Roh Kudus, cinta mati-matian kepada Tuhan Yesus, tidak kompromi terhadap dosa, dan akan bergerak untuk memenangkan jiwa. 4. Pentakosta ketiga lahir di Indonesia dan bergerak ke bangsa-bangsa. Gerakan ini dari timur ke barat dan akan kembali ke Yerusalem. 5. Pentakosta ketiga akan memberikan kuasa untuk menyelesaikan amanat agung, dan setelah itu Tuhan Yesus akan datang kembali. Dan mari bersama kita sepakat dan percaya mendeklarasikan firman Tuhan yang tertulis dalam Mazmur 91. Dalam lindungan Allah, orang yang duduk dalam lindungan yang maha tinggi dan bermalam dalam naungan yang maha kuasa akan berkata kepada Tuhan, tempat perlindunganku dan kubu pertahananku, Allahku yang kupercayai. Sungguh, Dialah yang akan melepaskan engkau dari jerat penangkap burung, dari penyakit sampar yang busuk. Dengan kepaknya Ia akan menudungi engkau, di bawah sayapnya engkau akan berlindung. Kesetiaannya ialah perisai dan pagar tembok. Engkau tak usah takut terhadap kedahsyatan malam, terhadap panah yang terbang di waktu siang, terhadap penyakit sampar yang berjalan di dalam gelap, terhadap penyakit menular yang mengamuk di waktu petang. Walau 1000 orang rebah di sisimu dan 10.000 di sebelah kananmu, tetapi itu tidak akan menimpamu. Engkau hanya menontonnya dengan matamu sendiri dan melihat pembalasan terhadap orang-orang fasik. Sebab Tuhan ialah tempat perlindunganmu. Yang maha tinggi telah kau buat tempat perteduhanmu. Malapetaka tidak akan menimpa kamu, dan tulah tidak akan mendekat kepada kemahmu. Sebab malaikat-malaikatnya akan diperintahkannya kepadamu untuk menjaga engkau di segala jalanmu. Mereka akan menatang engkau di atas tangannya, supaya kakimu jangan terantuk kepada batu. Singa dan ular tedung akan kau langkahi, engkau akan menginjak anak singa dan ular naga. Sungguh hatinya melekat kepadaku, maka aku akan meluputkannya. Aku akan membentenginya, sebab ia mengenal namaku. Bila ia berseru kepadaku, aku akan menjawab. Aku akan menyertai dia dalam kesesakan. Aku akan meluputkannya dan memuliakannya. Dengan panjang umur akan kukenyangkan dia, dan akan kuperlihatkan kepadanya keselamatan daripadaku. Haleluya. Amin.
Haleluya. Kasih tepuk tangan yang terbaik buat Tuhan Yesus. Puji nama Tuhan. Shalom. Sekali lagi saudara, shalom GPPRJ.
Haleluya. Senang rasanya bisa berjumpa kembali saudara. Kami bersuka cita menyambut Bapak Ibu saudara di rumah Tuhan pagi hari ini. Dan saudara, kalau hari ini saudara sudah ambil keputusan datang ke gereja, datang ke rumah Tuhan, artinya saya mau ajak kita sama-sama saudara untuk mari, jangan jadikan hari ini menjadi ibadah kita yang rutinitas semata saudara. Saya percaya kalau kita boleh ada sampai hari ini karena kebaikan Tuhan. Oleh sebab itu mari kita satukan tujuan saudara. Hari ini kita jadikan ibadah kita menjadi ibadah kita yang sejati. Amin. Kita satukan tujuan, kita tinggikan dan besarkan nama Tuhan di tempat ini. Saya percaya ketika nama Tuhan dipermuliakan, urapannya, kuasanya mengurapi setiap kita. Amin saudara. Saudara siap kasih yang terbaik buat Tuhan Yesus. Berikan tepuk tangan sekali lagi buat Tuhan Allah kita. Dan kita satu dalam doa. Bapa kami yang baik, terima kasih Tuhan untuk kebaikan-Mu yang tak pernah habis dalam setiap musim hidup kami Tuhan. Kami bersyukur pagi hari ini kami boleh berkumpul di rumah-Mu Tuhan. Kami bersehati memuji memuliakan nama Tuhan. Biar hari ini Tuhan kami gak mau kasih yang setengah-setengah. Tapi kami berikan yang terbaik. Kami mau menjadikan ibadah hari ini menjadi ibadah kami yang sejati Tuhan Yesus. Terima kasih Tuhan, terima kasih. Di dalam nama Tuhan Yesus Kristus kami beribadah. Haleluya. Amin. Setiap kami umat-Mu datang berkumpul Tuhan. Kami tinggikan dan besarkan nama Tuhan Yesus. Terima kasih Tuhan.
A thousand generations falling down in worship, sing the song of ages to the land. All who will believe will sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Song forever to the kami mengagumimu Tuhan.
Engkau Allah kami yang besar, Tuhan Yesus. Dengan apa kami balas segala kebaikan-Mu, Tuhan? Selain dengan pujian sembah kami yang terbaik. Menjadikan hari ini menjadi ibadah kami yang sejati, Tuhan. Kami gak mau jadikan ibadah ini sebagai rutinitas. Ibadah yang biasa-biasa aja, Tuhan. Tapi kami bawa pujian dari dalam hati kami. Mari jemaat Tuhan, saya ajak kita sama-sama angkat tanganmu saudara. Kita mau deklarasikan pujian ini bersama.
Ku kagum hormat akan engkau. Ku kagum hormat akan engkau. Kau Allah yang layak dipuji, ku kagum akan engkau. Kami kagum, ku kagum hormat.
Hati setiap kami nyatakan
ku hormat akan engkau.
Ku kagum,
ku kagum akan engkau. Kau Allah yang layak dipuji. Ku kagum akan engkau.
Segenap jiwa kami kagum makanan kau Tuhan, mari nyatakan.
Ku kagum hormat akan engkau.
Kami kagum.
Ku kagum hormat akan engkau.
Sebab engkau Allah yang layak.
Allah yang layak dipuji. Ku kagum akan engkau.
Jemaat Tuhan lebih lagi nyatakan. Tepuk tangan yang terbaik. Sorak-sorai kemuliaan untuk Tuhan Allah. kami kagum. Kami kagum akan Engkau Tuhan Allah kami yang besar, Allah kami yang luar biasa. Dan pagi hari ini kami siap bersuka cita demi nama-Mu Tuhan. Mari setiap kita yang siap bersuka cita, sama-sama kita nyatakan.
Amin. GBI PRJ shalom. Shalom. Sekali lagi shalom.
Shalom.
Saya percaya setiap kita pasti merasakan sukacita dari Tuhan. Amin.
Amin.
Boleh tengok kanan kirinya sama bilang kita punya Tuhan yang dahsyat. Because you deserve all the glory, all the honor goes to you, our Lord Jesus. Hallelujah!
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior. My God.
Tuhan yang besar. Yang lebih besar dari setiap masalahmu. Yang lebih besar dari setiap pergumulanmu. Amin. Kau yang percaya sorakan. Haleluya. Mari sambil bertepuk tangan saudara.
Sebab Tuhan maha besar dan sangat terpuji. Dia lebih dahsyat dari segala Allah.
Katakan dengan imanmu, come on.
Sebab Tuhan maha besar dan sangat terpuji. Kuasanya dahsyat menghancurkan musuh.
Kau yang percaya sorakan, yeah. Yeah. Mari tepuk tangan seirama untuk Tuhan kita yang besar. Haleluya. YBIPRJ, satukan suara kita bersama. Nyanyi untuk Tuhan, come on.
Ceritakanlah kemuliaannya di antara segala bangsa dan perbuatannya yang sungguh ajaib.
Kuasanya dahsyat, dahsyat, dahsyat.
Engkau dahsyat Tuhan dalam kehidupan kami. Amen. Mari beri salam, shalom Israel, damailah Israel. Kami berdoa juga Tuhan untuk bangsa kami Indonesia, diberkatilah Indonesia, biarlah perkenanan-Mu Tuhan selalu turun atas bangsa kami, di era Pentakosta yang ketiga ini Tuhan, biarlah Engkau mencurahkan roh-Mu yang dahsyat dan luar biasa untuk melawat Indonesia, sehingga setiap jiwa-jiwa boleh mengalami perjumpaan pribadi yang otentik dengan Engkau ya Tuhan, ada pertobatan, mereka kembali kepada kebenaran-Mu Tuhan, ada kasih mula-mula, dan biarlah selalu ada api doa, api pujian yang naik ke atas tahta-Mu ya Tuhan. Kami percaya Indonesia akan dipenuhi oleh kemuliaan Tuhan. Indonesia akan bangkit menjadi terang bagi bangsa-bangsa. Terima kasih Tuhan, berkati Presiden Jokowi dan wakilnya Pak Maruf Amin, menyelesaikan setiap tugas-tugas jabatannya dengan baik dan penuh tanggung jawab. Kami juga berdoa Tuhan untuk gembala sidang Pak Niko, Tuhan urapi berlimpah, berkati kesehatan, pelayanan dan pengembalaan hamba-Mu. Di era Pentakosta yang ketiga ini, Engkau terus pakai hamba-Mu dengan dahsyat dan luar biasa. Dimanapun hamba-Mu berada, biar ada penyertaan dan perlindungan Tuhan. Kami berdoa juga untuk gembala CK7 Dr. Yanto, Engkau urapi berlimpah hamba-Mu, berkati pelayanan pengembalaannya Tuhan, biarlah hikmat-Mu terus turun Tuhan, sehingga terus membawa kami umat-Mu menjadi umat yang layak dan berkenan di hadapan Tuhan. Engkau yang senantiasa menyertai, melindungi hamba-Mu dan seluruh keluarga besarnya selalu aman di dalam perlindungan Tuhan. Kami berdoa juga Tuhan untuk generasi Yeremia yang akan bangkit menjadi terang bagi gereja-gereja Tuhan, bagi Indonesia bahkan bangsa-bangsa. Generasi yang hidup berkemenangan, generasi yang mau bergerak untuk memenangkan jiwa dan ikut mengambil bagian untuk menyelesaikan amanat agung. Terima kasih Bapa, inilah yang menjadi doa-doa kami hanya di dalam nama Tuhan Yesus. Haleluya. Amin.
Bapak Ibu Saudara yang dikasih Tuhan Yesus, saya percaya setiap kita pasti yakin bahwa kasih Tuhan yang begitu besar, yang tidak bersyarat, yang begitu sempurna, hanya kita dapat temukan dalam Tuhan Yesus. Amin. Tuhan selalu mengasihi kita, tidak memandang siapa kita. Tuhan selalu bilang bahwa aku mengasihimu. Jadi mari hari ini sama-sama kita mau datang ke Tuhan. Kita mau bilang terima kasih Tuhan Yesus buat kasih-Mu dalam hidup kita, dalam hidup kami. Sebab Engkau begitu baik dalam hidup setiap kami ya Bapa. Terima kasih Tuhan Yesus. Ini setiap kami Tuhan. Kami menyatakan bahwa kasih-Mu begitu sempurna dalam hidup kami. Tidak ada satu hari pun Tuhan kami tidak merasakan kasih-Mu yang nyata dalam hidup setiap kami. Setiap kami yang mau bersyukur, yang mau berterima kasih Tuhan Yesus.
Kasih Tuhan sungguh mulia, tulus dan sempurna mengasihiku. Pengorbanan di Kalvari sungguh berharga, Kau tebus dosaku. Terpujilah Tuhan Yesus, ditinggikan di atas pujian. Dari dalam lubuk hatiku, ku sujud dan berterima kasih. Terpujilah Tuhan Yesus, ditinggikan di atas pujian. Oh, oh. sujud dan berterima kasih.
Terima kasih buat kasih setiamu dalam hidup setiap kami, Tuhan Yesus. Ini setiap kami yang bersyukur kepada-Mu. Amin.
Kasih Tuhan tak bersyarat, tak seperti cinta yang ada di dunia, selalu memberi lebih dari yang layak ku terima di hidupku. Terpujilah Tuhan Yesus, ditinggikan di atas pujian. Dalam lubuk hatiku, ku sujud dan berterima kasih. Terpujilah Tuhan Yesus, ditinggikan di atas pujian.
Hi Checker 7, it is wonderful to be back again to bring you the Word of God as we worship Jesus together. I trust that you have had a great week, and I pray that the Word that I've prepared for you this time round is going to strengthen your faith and keep you closer to Jesus. And before I share the message, let us pray. Father God, we thank you today. We thank you for this time that we can just move away from all the busyness of our lives and not allow any distraction to come in the way as we dedicate this time and this moment to worship you by listening to the Word of God. Father, I pray, let your Word do a work on the inside of us and take us to the place that you want us to grow into in our faith as we become more and more mature in our faith and in Christ's likeness. Thank you, God. In Jesus' most precious name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Growing up in a small town in Sabah called Tawau is very, very interesting. You know, back in the 80s and early 90s, it really feels like a cowboy town. So I live in a place that is quite near to the town, but I need to walk to the town because there was no bus. And what happened is that every time when I want to go into the town center, I will walk past a flea market, a market where a lot of traders are peddling with their stuff and trying to sell something. And I'm always very intrigued. Every time I walk past there, there will be people with a lighter trying to light the strap of a watch. And then they'll tell you, boss, this is real leather, really good one. We are not cheating you. And I always feel very intrigued. Of course, after many times walking past, eventually I bought a watch. You know, it wasn't very expensive. I bought a watch because, yeah, you know what? This is real leather. What is real? It is a very critical question that all of us need to have an answer in the world that we live in today. With the internet that is growing so rapidly, and fake news are so hard to believe, right, these days, but you see something online, you're not very sure whether it is real or not, right? But this question of battling whether something is real is becoming more and more challenging, and it's becoming tougher and tougher. How do you know it is real? Can you prove it? And if we think that this is a modern day problem, maybe we are not quite familiar with the Bible. It's actually an age-old problem. Even the days of Jesus, when Jesus was walking on the earth, or the days before Jesus. And so James addressed this issue. Is your faith real? How do I know it's real? How do you know this faith is real? And can you prove it? The tension between faith of what we believe in Christ and works of what we do in our lives is constant, and it is challenging. We live in a Christian world today where very often you will hear things like, oh, I only have to have faith. If I have faith, I can move mountains, everything will be fine. As long as I just trust in God, everything will be okay. Or you are on the other side of the camp where you are made to believe, although it may not be purposely, you are made to believe that you have to work very hard to earn your salvation, to earn the pleasure of God, that God is actually happy with you. So there's no in-between in the world that we live in. Either you are, I only need faith camp, or I have to earn the pleasure of God camp, and there is no in between. You either be just trusting God and worshiping Jesus and reading your Bible and praying and you're fine, or no, it's not good enough. You have to serve, you have to minister, you have to do this and that in order to earn the pleasure and whether God is pleased with you or not. Now, so when you and I become a follower of Jesus, this question of faith and works, if we do not understand how they are, it is going to be tough. It's going to be very challenging because your mindset will be, oh, sometimes I'm faith, sometimes I'm work. It depends on what I'm doing or where I am at. And when you put these two words together, faith and works, it's just not logical. Because how can they even exist together? There's an explosion of misunderstanding and conflict. You see Christians debating or confusing frustration, and people start to fight with each other when it comes to this, or endless theological debates of who is right or which one is right. Now, let's go to the Bible and see whether this confusion are valid or not, okay? Now, let's go to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to verse 9. Paul said this, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." Paul said it very clear. It is actually the grace of God that saves us in the first place, and our response is faith, all right? Our response is faith. Therefore, this is a gift from God. It comes from God Himself. So it is not your work. It is not something that you can do to achieve it, right? And none of us as followers of Jesus have a problem with this verse. You know that you did not earn your salvation. It was Jesus Christ who chose to die on the cross for you and for me. And then in Romans chapter 3, verse 28, "For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law." So now Paul also said that, "For we maintain that a man, you and I, are made right because of faith and not because of observing all the laws that are there made available." Now, well, if we just listen to Paul or read Paul or hear Paul, you know what? Everything is by faith and faith alone and nothing else. Honestly, if that is what we read the Bible and that's all it is, we are fine. So you don't have to do anything. Jesus Christ died on the cross for you. You need to just open your heart and receive Jesus into your heart with faith. Then you will be justified by God. However, we have a challenge. The challenge is actually found in the writing of James, the brother of Jesus. James chapter 2, verse 24, he says this, "You see that a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone." Now there's a curveball. James is saying, you know what? You are justified by what you do and not by faith alone. Now there is a contradiction. James, I am not sure whether you are in agreement with Paul, but why are you both saying something that is totally different? And on top of that, because these are biblical truths, it is affecting how you and I live. Two verses down, James says this, "As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead." So now he is making it even more serious that your faith without action is actually dead. When you read the scripture and maybe you're just still working out your faith, maybe you're new in your walk with Jesus, and then you happen to read this passages together, and now you may be hearing me reading this out to you for the first time, they just simply compound your misery, isn't it? So who is right, who is wrong? Is this just faith alone, or faith alone not enough? Who should I listen to? Or maybe some of us have, over the years, because we have not addressed this issue in our lives, we kind of like compartmentalize it. Now is the moment for faith, later is a moment for works. But is that how we are supposed to live? Is the Bible consistent, you wonder? Perhaps they do not know what they are doing. And if they do not know what they're doing and it's so contradictory to one another, how can I know that the Bible is true? Well, today I want to suggest to you to take a step back and look at it again. Were Paul and James fighting with each other? Were they having conflicting ideas about how to live this life of faith in Christ? If we think that they are fighting each other, then of course you will have no choice but to pick a side. Either you're on Paul's side or you're on James's side. But what if they are not fighting? What if they are not against each other, but in fact, they are trying to attack a problem, which is this whole issue of faith and works, totally from a different perspective, a different angle, but complete the whole picture. It is like you look at a coin and they're both sides. If you see this side of the coin and say, this is the correct side of the coin, but the other person that's seeing the coin from the other side will also say, hey, my side has a different picture altogether. This is the correct coin. But you know what? That's sometimes our struggle as a believer. If we just see a matter, an issue from just one side and we think that it is real, we've forgotten that perhaps that same coin has two sides. Let me explain to you. Paul and James were simply teaching us not to live a either or kind of life, but one that is mature and encompassing, having the ability to see the both sides of the coin that actually completes the coin, that actually mature our faith. You see, faith and works are not mutually exclusive. That means you don't need to be either or. And this is powerful because why? They can be complementing each other for a complete expression of how Christ intended our walk to be. So it is not, oh, faith alone is good enough, or works alone is not, works alone is not good. No, no. Jesus is using what Paul and James knows in order to show us that it is not about which side you are on, but seeing the coin from both sides. So what was actually Paul doing? You see, Paul was a Pharisee and he came from a line of rabbis and teachers that have taught him to observe the law, to do the things of the law. So he was actually attacking an idea where in order for us to earn favor before God, it is pure legalism. How do we do cleansing? How do we eat? And how do we carry ourselves? How we are not supposed to work on a Sabbath? And so Paul says, if you think that it is by doing all these things that you are saved, then you miss the point. And it actually, think about it for a while, it actually undercuts and discounts the work of Christ on the cross, which means if we feel that we have to do work, that's why Paul is teaching against it's not your work, it is your faith in Christ. Because if we think that faith alone is not enough, we have to work to earn our salvation, then we are actually indirectly saying that the death of Jesus Christ on the cross is not good enough for you and for me. That means it is good enough, but not enough. You have to top up, you know, you have to do a bit more in order to earn your right standing with God. And Paul was attacking that. Paul understood how people from where he came from had to keep observing and obeying the law, lest they will not be received by God. But Paul says, look, there is a good news. And the good news is Christ Jesus our Lord. He died for us. He died for you and me. He paid the price on the cross so that you don't have to earn it yourself. Paul is saying, you cannot work to earn your salvation. You and I today, you cannot work to earn your salvation. God is pleased with you because He's a God of love. God is pleased with you because He is a God of grace. And that is His nature. There's nothing that you and I can do that can take away that nature of God away from Him. Even when we sin against God, even when we have done wrong, even when we failed Him, even when we consistently and continually fail to do what we know is right, but continually doing what we know is wrong. That's how magnificent our God is. And so I want you to know that faith in Jesus alone is enough. Why? Because His blood that washes away our sin is complete. Now, if that's what Paul was addressing, what was James trying to achieve? James was basically fighting with easy believism. Easy believism. There arise at his time people that simply just, as long as you believe, then you're fine. As long as you believe, there's nothing else you need to do. If Paul's issue that he was trying to address was against legalism, whereby you have to do more than you have to, more than the work on the cross to be saved, here is another extreme. James is addressing the issue of easy believism. As long as you have Jesus, you don't have to do anything else. As long as you believe in Christ, you're fine. You can keep sinning. You have no discipline, no lifestyle, no habits, no nothing Christian to keep. Just keep going. You are fine. Just live your life as if there was no God in you. So James was trying to address that issue because to many people, it could be just an intellectual assent. Oh, I believe, I understand, and that's fine. It's just head knowledge. And then it caused people to become selfish and self-centered. James is not arguing that works must be added to faith, but that genuine faith will always be evidenced by works. Once again, James is not arguing that works must be added to faith, but actually genuine faith will always evidence by works. Let me give you an example. How do you know that my love for my family is real? Or I can just keep, oh, I believe, I trust, I know, and it's in my head, but I never say it. Or even if I just say it, but you never see it. How do you know it is for real? Oh, I love my family, but you never see me spending time with my family. You never see me hanging out with my children. You never see me accompanying them with their schoolwork or praying with them or reading the Bible with them. James is trying to say that just because you claim that you love God, but or love Jesus, but if you do nothing about it, how can you prove it? I love my family, and I want you to know, I don't do things with them, loving them or reading the Bible with them, cooking meals for them, doing homework with them. It's like a chore or responsibility. I do it because I love them. And it is when you see what I do for them and with them, that my love for them is evidence. So James is trying to say that this part is also equally important. If you say you love God, if you say you love Jesus, but you don't go to church, you don't read your Bible, you don't pray, then is there even a relationship between God and you? Faith trusts God and obey God, but works are expressed in a life of loving God and others. So that means when you grow in your faith, you learn to trust and obey God more, but works are then as a result of that trusting and growing and maturing in faith. Your life is expressed in your love for God by the things that you do for God and for other people. And we must remember, we are only doing it out of a place where we have been loved and not stepping out to do all these things so that I can be loved. You and I cannot do anything more in order for God to love you more. God has already loved you and me with His perfect love. And so we are only doing all these things out of a place where we have been loved by God. James chapter 2, verse 18 to 19 say this, "But someone will say, 'You have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I'll show you my faith by what I do.' You believe that there's one God, good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. 'You have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I'll show you my faith by what I do.'" Faith works. Faith go to work. And true faith is expressed in works. I honestly find it very difficult. If someone tell me that they love God, they love Jesus, but they do nothing as a result of that. It's the same, right? You can say you love your children, but you do nothing. You never talk to them. You never spend time with them. You never listen to their stories. You never listen to what they like. And maybe sometimes it's just not very, very complicated. Hold their hands when they cross the street. Buy them an ice cream. Pray with them before they go to bed at night. Love them. And your love is expressed through actions, not just head knowledge. And so that's the reason when James writes about faith, he says, "You and I cannot be hearers only, but also doers." We got to be a doer of the Word of God. You have to walk the talk. You have to walk the talk. And yes, of course, every one of us takes time to grow. Every one of us is at a different level of maturity. As you deepen your relationship with Christ, with God, and as you mature, you will find yourself, maybe in the beginning, it's just responsibility. Oh, I have to go to church. Oh, I have to serve. Oh, I have to give. Oh, I have to do this. I have to do that. Maybe in the beginning, as your faith is taking shape, it feels a lot like schedules and responsibilities. But after you've been following Jesus for a while, and you have been with God for a while, and you've developed that love and maturity, serving God should not be seen as a chore anymore, but it's out of a place of joy. Giving should be out of a place of gratefulness. And doing things in the house of God or for other people is actually an expression of our love for Jesus. James chapter 1, verse 22 to 25. "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forget what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does." And James is trying to say, look, the laws of God gives freedom when you do them, which means you and I have to understand what God has given us to do in the Word of God is actually for our benefit. It's actually to liberate us. Following the laws of God is not to torture you. And I think that is where a lot of people get wrong. For example, the Bible says, do not commit adultery. Oh, you know, like, I don't want to be a Christian. It's so hard following Jesus. Like, adultery standard in the scripture is so high. Even if you look at a woman with a second thought, you've committed adultery. And we feel like, no, I want to still be free. I don't want to commit to one relationship. I want to have, you know, flexible and openness. And no, when God creates the institution of marriage, it is a covenant that is given to us in order that you and your spouse, you and your wife, or you and your husband has a space of freedom where both of you can enjoy and trust each other without breaking trust. But the world tells you that's so old-fashioned. But when you betray the trust of each other, you lose that freedom. You lose that ability to be with yourself because you are no longer in that place where you can truly enjoy your life. You will always be in a state of fixing the problem. The Bible says, when you look at the Word of God, do the Word of God, so that you will not be like someone that look at the mirror and then after that, forgetting how you look like. But when you do the Word of God, the Bible says, it will bless you. Do you believe that all the commandments of God are actually for our benefit? That it is actually good for us? The book of James highlighted three things for all of us. First one is the controlled tongue. Faith in Christ should lead us to a place where when we partner with the Holy Spirit, the conviction that the Holy Spirit gives us will control our tongue, number one. Number two, as a result of faith in Christ, there is a care for the needy, for those who are in need. And number three, the conviction of the Holy Spirit on the inside of us should lead to a personal purity of life, a consecration of how we live. And so the moment we apply faith in Christ and allowing the Holy Spirit to live on the inside of us, when we open our heart, the way we speak should change. The way we live our lives with others should change. And the way we live our own lives should change. And so you begin to see what James is actually trying to say is that the power of God that resides on the inside of us control what I say, should control how I live, and should also control how I think. Now, this control is not like, oh, I don't want this. I don't want to be controlled. But no, when we submit ourselves to God in this manner, the way the conviction of the Holy Spirit works within us actually enriches the quality of our lives. By the words we speak, we are careful not to gossip or harm others. We are careful, well, in today's world, it would be don't simply type anything on the internet or make comments that you don't mean control. And it's actually eventually good for us to care for others. Christian faith is powerful because whatever God has done for you and for me is to empower us to be a blessing to other people. It's never about ourselves. The difference of self-care in the scripture is for the benefit of others and not for ourselves. And also after that, the purity of our lives in the way we think, that we do not allow evil, destructive thoughts to reside in our brain, to cause us to be negative, to cause us to think negative of other people. Of course, now we come to this place where we ask ourselves, yes, I have Jesus in my life. I have the Holy Spirit on the inside of me. I know I should control my tongue. I know I should be a blessing to other people. I know I should live a consecrated life. But I'm nowhere near. What should I do? I want you to know the Holy Spirit on the inside of us creates that tension. That means if you know that you are struggling, if you know that I got to fight this loose tongue of mine, I've got to learn to be more generous and more caring. I'm battling, I'm fighting that I know the way I think ought to be more purified. I want you to know that's the good news. The good news is that when there is a tension, you know the Holy Spirit is working on the inside of you to convict you to lead a different life altogether as compared to a life without God. You would just say whatever you want because you think that's right. You would just not care for other people but yourself and you think it's all right. or you will not have a purified thoughts because I'm human. The moment that conscience is seared, as the Bible says, we know that we are actually in trouble because we do not have God working on the inside of us. If there is no tension, means your faith is dead. If you don't feel bad, means your faith is dead. If you don't care for others and you don't even feel wrong about it, it means your faith is dead. If you don't control your thoughts and you just say, I'm human, it's not my fault, I don't care, then you know that your faith is not alive. God sent Jesus to die on a cross for you and for me. Not just you can get a ticket and go to heaven. No. God sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross to bring us back to the fold of God so that we can enjoy a quality of life, so that we can enjoy a life that is godly, that is truly beneficial, that is truly the original design of God for all eternity. I don't want you to just have faith as head knowledge, but faith that is not practiced. Don't worry if you are not able to do many things that the Bible is saying today. But let's take the first step and say, Holy Spirit, invite the Holy Spirit into your heart and say, Holy Spirit, I want to partner with you. I want to submit to you and allow you to transform the way I think, to transform the way I speak, and to transform the way I lead my life. If you are listening to me today, or maybe you just kind of like click and found this talk, I pray it is not just a good talk. I pray it's a talk that will cause you to rethink your life and will cause you to open your heart to receive Jesus Christ into your life, to be your Lord and your Savior, to invite Jesus to be the Lord of your everyday life, because that is where a true good life comes from. Amen. So before we go, I want to pray. And today, if you want to invite Jesus into your heart, I want to you to say this prayer together with me. And after that, you can respond and write to the church and have someone to walk with you so that you can begin your new life in Jesus. Is it okay? Let us pray. Father God, thank you for speaking your word today. I learned that faith is not just head knowledge, but true faith naturally expressed itself in works because of a love that we have experienced. Thank you, God, today for loving me and not judging me. I come before you as who I am. I confess that I've sinned against you. And right now, I want to open my heart to receive Jesus into my life to be my Savior. And on top of that, to be my Lord, because I know when I subject my life to the Lordship of Christ, the quality of my life gets better. I may not be perfect, I may not be good in doing everything, but God, I want this to be the first step of me drawing closer to you. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for all that you have done for me. I receive you, Lord, into my life. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you say that prayer, feel free to reach out to someone to walk with you. Or if you have never been to church, try to join a community so that your faith can grow and flourish. Bless you. Until the next time, may God be with you each day of your life. Take care now and God bless. Bye-bye.
Shalom. Gembala dan seluruh pengerja CK7 serta jemaat Tuhan mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Pastor Kevin Lu yang telah memberkati kita semua melalui penyampaian pesan firman Tuhan pada hari ini. Tuhan Yesus memberkati Pastor dan keluarga berlimpah-limpah. Amin. Berikut kami sampaikan beberapa pengumuman. Ibadah Raya Philips streaming hari Minggu tanggal 5 Mei 2024 pukul 7, 9, 11.30, 14, dan 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat akan dilayani oleh Evangelist Sylvia Wati MTH. Ibadah tayang ulang atau rerun yang dilakukan secara on-site untuk ibadah Mandarin Service dan 2PM yang Professional and Couple Service di channel YouTube GBI BRJ CK7. Untuk persembahan umum atau kolekte, perpuluhan jemaat, ucapan syukur, dan lain-lain dapat dilakukan melalui e-banking, mobile banking, ATM maupun online di website ke rekening persembahan CK7, BCA Cabang Tamrin dengan nomor account 206-333-8222 atas nama GBI BRJ. Ibadah Minggu tanggal 5 Mei 2024 diadakan di GBI BRJ pukul 7 dan 9 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Evangelist Indri Pardede. Pukul 11.30 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pastor Andy Junaidi BSC. Pukul 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Henry Salak Parang. GBI Intercon pukul 7, 9, dan 11 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Bapak Roni Immanuel. Pukul 16 dan 18 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh PDM Grace Suhadi. GBI Alam Sutramo pukul 7, 9, 11, dan 15 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Ruin Ong. Pukul 13 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Dr. Nato Semkup Trenwi PhD. Pukul 17 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh PDP Charles Jeremia. GBI PRJ Pluit pukul 9, 11, dan 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Rorem Mentanu Jaya MSC. GBI PRJ Mandarin pukul 9 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Dr. Anto Simko Putra, MD PhD. GBI HCR pukul 8 dan 10 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Adi Putra Hasani STH. GBI St. Moritz pukul 9, 11, dan 13 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Henry Salak Parang. Pukul 15 dan 17 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Adi Putra Hasani STH. Ibadah Raya Onsite di atas disertai juga dengan ibadah pemuda dan anak secara onsite. Sehubungan dengan Libur Nasional Hari Buruh Internasional pada hari Rabu tanggal 1 Mei 2024, maka diinformasikan doa fajar, Bible Study, dan kantor OTP CK7 pada hari tersebut dileburkan dan aktif kembali pada hari Kamis 2 Mei 2024. Ibadah kenaikan Tuhan Yesus via live streaming hari Kamis tanggal 9 Mei 2024 pukul 7, 9, 11.30, 14, dan 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat akan dilayani oleh Gembala Sidang Pendeta Dr. Insinyur Niko Nyoto Harjo. Ibadah onsite kenaikan Tuhan Yesus Kristus pada hari Kamis 9 Mei 2024 di GBI PRJ dan GBI PRJ Mandarin Service pukul 8 dan 10.30 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh Pendeta Robin Ong. Pukul 14 dan 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh Pendeta Johan Lumendong. GBI Intercon pukul 7, 9, dan 11 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh Pendeta Dr. Yanto Simko Putra MD PhD. Pukul 16 dan 18 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh Pendeta Stephen Jaya Saputra SMTH. GBI Alam Sutramo pukul 9 dan 11 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh Pendeta Johan Lumendong. Pukul 15 dan 17 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh PDP Hartono SE. GBI PRJ Pluit pukul 9 dan 11 waktu Indonesia Barat dilayani oleh Pendeta Rorem Mentanu Jaya MSE. Pukul 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Robertus Purwadi SSPD. GBI St. Moritz pukul 9, 11, dan 13 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Robertus Purwadi SSPD. Pukul 17 waktu Indonesia Barat, dilayani oleh Pendeta Rubin Ong. Ibadah tersebut disertai juga dengan ibadah pemuda dan anak secara on-site.
Halo, Shalom. Saya Sinta, mama dari Gracella. Beberapa tahun yang lalu, anak saya mengikuti acara retret atau kids camp. Menurut saya, acara ini sangat bagus untuk diikuti anak-anak. Karena setelah dari retret, anak saya semakin bertumbuh dan mengalami pengalaman-pengalaman yang baru bersama Tuhan. Dan saya bangga, sampai hari ini, anak saya masih pelayanan di GTC. Saya bersyukur saya dan keluarga bertumbuh di dalam gereja GBI PRJ CK7 yang memfasilitasi saya dan keluarga dalam kegiatan kerohanian, terutama anak-anak. Yuk Bapak Ibu, kita daftarkan anak-anak kita dalam kegiatan Kids Camp tahun ini. Dan saya percaya ini akan menjadi berkat buat anak-anak kita semua.
You are worthy to be praised. semakin hari bertambah dengan usianya, ya. Kalau wanita di atas 40 tahun, kemudian pria di atas 50 tahun, itu memang mulai terjadi penurunan hormon-hormon.
Sekian pengumuman pada hari ini. Terima kasih atas perhatian Bapak Ibu sekalian. Tuhan Yesus memberkati.
Terimalah berkat yang berlimpah-limpah dari Allah Bapa, kasih karunia di dalam anaknya yang tunggal, Yesus Kristus. Persekutuan yang manis dengan Roh Kudus menyertai kita mulai saat ini, sampai Tuhan Yesus datang kembali untuk kedua kalinya, menjemput kita di awan-awan yang permai, bahkan untuk selama-lamanya. Semua yang percaya katakan amin. Tuhan memberkati saudara-saudara sekalian, and God bless you all.
Shalom saudara. Beberapa bulan terakhir gereja kita sudah mulai masuk dalam pelayanan intergenerational, atau bisa juga disebut lintas generasi. Istilah ini mulai muncul pada akhir abad ke-20 ketika penamaan generasi seperti baby boomer lahir untuk mengidentifikasi fenomena banyaknya anak-anak yang lahir pasca Perang Dunia Kedua pada tahun 1945 sampai 1960-an. Penamaan generasi millennials yang lahir menjelang pembukaan milenium yang baru, yaitu tahun 2000, dipopulerkan oleh William Strauss dan Neil Howe, yang pada saat itu adalah penulis buku dan juga konsultan sosiologis. Dan teori mereka masih dipakai sampai hari ini untuk mempermudah mengidentifikasi perbedaan generasi yang ada di gereja. Namun ternyata, perbedaan generasi ini menunjukkan fenomena yang menarik, yaitu kontribusi setiap generasi terhadap gereja berbeda antara satu dengan yang lainnya, dan kebutuhan mereka juga berbeda antara satu generasi dengan yang lainnya. Disinilah letak fungsi utama dari pelayanan lintas generasi. Alih-alih berfokus kepada satu generasi saja, gereja melihat sebuah pelayanan yang mewakili dan membuka interaksi antar generasi di dalam sebuah gereja lokal. Lalu apa dampaknya? Dampaknya adalah bahwa setiap karunia dan panggilan dari masing-masing generasi bisa terwakili, dan kebutuhan setiap generasi terjawab. Kita sadar bahwa terkadang menjaga hubungan di antara yang sama generasinya saja sudah susah, apalagi membangun hubungan lintas generasi. Tetapi inilah tantangan gereja zaman sekarang. Jadi, apa yang perlu dibangun dalam sebuah hubungan lintas generasi? Ada tiga area besar yang perlu dibangun menurut David Kahneman dalam bukunya Faith for Exiles. Yang pertama adalah shared experience. Hubungan itu betul-betul terbentuk ketika dua orang atau lebih mau berkomitmen untuk meluangkan waktu bersama-sama. Dan walaupun sepertinya mudah, kenyataannya tidak semudah itu. Sebuah pertanyaan sederhana. Apakah kita suka menghabiskan waktu bersama dengan orang-orang percaya lainnya dalam komunitas gereja lokal? Bagaimana dengan orang-orang yang berbeda rentang usia dengan kita? Diskusi dan interaksi yang terjadi antar generasi akan menumbuhkan hubungan yang berkualitas. Yang kedua adalah shared goals. Hubungan lintas generasi tidak terjadi begitu saja. Perlu niat dan tujuan yang jelas dari kedua belah pihak. Apa yang ingin dicapai dari hubungan lintas generasi tersebut? Seperti ketika Elia berjumpa dengan Elisa. hubungan yang tercipta memiliki tujuan yang jelas, yaitu untuk mewarisi pengalaman, pengurapan, dan panggilan dari Elia kepada Elisa, atau ketika Paulus memanggil Timotius. Tujuannya pun jelas, yaitu untuk mendidik dan memperlengkapi Timotius muda untuk menjadi hamba Allah yang nantinya akan meneruskan pelayanan Injil di tempat yang sudah ditentukan Allah baginya. Yang ketiga adalah shared emotions. Manusia adalah makhluk yang juga memiliki emosi. Dan di dalam membangun hubungan pertemanan ataupun mentoring, emosi memainkan peranan yang sangat penting. David Kinnaman menulis bahwa murid yang tangguh adalah mereka yang tertanam dalam gereja lokal yang memiliki penerimaan seperti keluarga. Apakah berarti gereja hanya berfokus menumbuhkan emosi positif saja? Tentunya tidak, sebab Alkitab pun meminta kita untuk menegur mereka yang hidup dalam dosa. Tetapi, iklim emosi yang sehat akan membantu generasi muda untuk merasa diterima di gereja lokal mereka sebagai anak dan sekaligus dibentuk untuk menjadi murid yang tangguh. Di dalam Mazmur 78 ayat 4 dikatakan, "Kami akan ceritakan kepada angkatan yang kemudian puji-pujian kepada Tuhan dan kekuatannya dan perbuatan-perbuatan ajaib yang telah dilakukannya." Pemazmur dalam hal ini Asaf memiliki komitmen untuk meneruskan pengetahuan akan mujizat Tuhan kepada generasi berikutnya agar tidak terputus ingatan mereka tentang Tuhan. Begitu juga dengan pelayanan lintas generasi. Ini dilakukan karena visi yang Tuhan berikan kepada gerejanya begitu besar dan begitu luas serta tidak mungkin diselesaikan hanya dalam waktu satu generasi saja. Artinya apa? Segala pengalaman, pengurapan, dan kesaksian hidup dari generasi sebelumnya perlu diteruskan kepada generasi penerus. Anak-anak muda yang berdiri di atas pengurapan dan pengalaman generasi sebelumnya akan bergerak lebih cepat, lebih tepat, dan lebih diurapi. Kesimpulannya adalah hubungan lintas generasi membutuhkan niat dari kedua belah pihak untuk saling merendahkan hati, mencari kepentingan bersama, dan kehendak Tuhan. Apa yang dibangun untuk diteruskan kepada generasi berikutnya bahkan tidak hanya ketiga hal di atas ini, yakni shared experience, goals, dan emotions, tapi juga shared faith. Seperti yang dialami anak rohani Paulus, yaitu Timotius. 2 Timotius 1 ayat 5 menunjukkan dengan jelas kepada kita bagaimana Timotius menerima warisan iman yang luar biasa dari ibunya dan neneknya sendiri. Sebab aku teringat akan imanmu yang tulus ikhlas, yaitu iman yang pertama-tama hidup di dalam nenekmu Lois dan di dalam ibumu Eunike, dan yang aku yakin hidup juga di dalam dirimu. Gereja yang membangun budaya lintas generasi memahami bahwa kehendak Tuhan untuk zaman ini berarti kehendak Tuhan untuk setiap generasi yang ada sekarang. Untuk itu, membangun jembatan yang menghubungkan lintas generasi perlu dibangun agar suara Roh Kudus bisa secara tepat direalisasikan kepada setiap generasi yang ada di gereja dan di luar gereja hari ini. Saudara, untuk penjelasan lengkapnya dari tim teologi kami, silahkan klik link yang ada di atas atau scan QR code yang tersedia. Tuhan Yesus memberkati.